Welcome, this is Dr. G, and in this video, I will be discussing in-depth vitamin B1, thiamine. As always, you got this. Come on, let's go. All right, so first, let's take a look at the structure of thiamine. There you see, that's the structure of thiamine. Okay, let's move on. Thiamine is found in pretty much everything we eat, and that's good news for two reasons. The first reason is if you eat somewhat of a balanced diet, then you have no worries about being deficient in thiamine. The second piece of good news, you don't have to worry about memorizing what foods contain thiamine, because all the foods do. This is more for testing purposes than anything else, but there's a lot of thiamine in the husks in the brown rice. So technically, for someone to only eat polished white rice, they could be at risk for thiamine deficiency. And of course, nowadays, there are a lot of thiamine supplements to take for those that want to up their thiamine game. Along with the other nutrients that we eat, thiamine will get digested and broken down in the digestive tract before being absorbed and then stored in the liver. Now, remember, thiamine, or all vitamin Bs, are water-soluble, so not a lot of it gets stored. For those that are stored, 80% of them will be stored as TPP, which is the active metabolite of thiamine. 20% will be stored as the original thiamine molecule. Let's talk about thiamine pyrophosphate, or TPP. It's the same structure as thiamine with just two phosphate attached. That's why sometimes we can even call it thiamine diphosphate. Like we mentioned before, it is the active metabolite of thiamine, and it will act as a coenzyme for four enzymes listed here. All four enzymes here play significant roles in our metabolic pathways. However, notice how there's asterisks beside the pyruvate dehydrogenase, alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase, and the branched-chain keto acid dehydrogenase. Well, those asterisks represent that these three enzymes are something we called TLCFN enzymes. What does that mean? That means all three of these enzymes, and only these three enzymes, all require the same five coenzymes, abbreviated by T, which stands for TPP, L, which is lipoic acid, C, which is CoA, F, which is FAD, and N, which is NAD. The enzyme pyruvate dehydrogenase, or PDH, plays a critical role in glucose metabolism. It catalyzes a reaction that converts pyruvate to acetyl-CoA. The enzyme alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase catalyzes one of many steps in the TCA cycle. In this particular step, it catalyzes the reaction from alpha-ketoglutarate to succinyl-CoA. The branched-chain keto acid dehydrogenase is a part of your amino acid metabolism. It converts branched-chain amino acids, which is leucine, isoleucine, and valine, and it converts them to propanol-CoA. Finally, the transketolase. The transketolase catalyzes a step in your hexose monophosphate shunt, or your HMP shunt. This shunt normally is an alternative pathway to glycolysis, but in certain cells, like your red blood cells, that cannot do glycolysis, the HMP shunt is the only way they can metabolize glucose. Let's now take a look at some common causes of thiamine deficiency. The most common cause by far is alcoholism, because alcohol inhibits thiamine absorption. Malnutrition can also be a cause, especially in the third world countries. Like we said before, eating white rice instead of brown rice. And to a lesser degree, we have Crohn's disease and renal failure requiring dialysis as other causes of deficiency. It should come to no surprise that a deficiency in thiamine will mess up your metabolism. It is going to hinder your glucose metabolism, which will reduce the amount of ATP you make. Naturally, your highly aerobic organs, or organs that require a lot of ATP, such as your brain and your heart, those will be affected first. Let's take a look at these four different conditions that could result from thiamine deficiency. On the top, we have the Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome, which primarily affects your central nervous system. On the left, we have the dry beriberi, which primarily affects your peripheral nervous system. On the right, we have wet beriberi, which affects your cardiovascular system. And on the bottom, we have the infantile beriberi. Of the four conditions, the Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome is by far the most important because it is going to be the one that's most frequently tested. Like we mentioned earlier, it affects your central nervous system, particularly the thalamus and mammillary bodies of your brain. Because of that, we tend to call it the cerebral beriberi as a way to remember it and differentiate it from dry beriberi and wet beriberi. Notice the Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome is actually made up of the Wernicke encephalopathy and the Korsakoff syndrome. They both have different types of symptoms, and usually it's the Wernicke encephalopathy symptoms that appear first, And then once those subsides, then the Korsakoff syndrome symptoms appear. As far as symptoms go, nothing really jumps off the page for Wernicke encephalopathy. Ataxia, or the loss of your coordination, ophthalmoplegia, or the weakness of your eye muscles, and nystagmus, or the rapid coordinate movements of your eye, these are all pretty common manifestations whenever we have something wrong with our CNS. But for the Korsakoff syndrome, it might be worth remembering the permanent amnesia, or the permanent memory loss associated, because that's pretty unique for Korsakoff syndrome. Next, we have wet beriberi, which can cause dilated cardiomyopathy, as well as systemic vasodilation, which can of course result in high output cardiac failure, which can result in fluid retention, ultimately leading to edema. Dry beriberi, what affects the peripheral nervous system, and it can cause polyneuritis, where all your peripheral nerves can start malfunctioning. Symptoms include symmetrical muscle wasting, weakness, and hyporeflexia. And lastly, for infantile beriberi, it's usually in babies that are breastfed by mothers who are thiamine deficient. Symptoms are not very unique at all, they're pretty generic. You got vomiting, convulsions, hyporeflexia, tachycardia or a fast heart rate, as well as heart failure. Now let's talk about treatment for thiamine deficiency. It should come to no surprise that thiamine itself is part of the treatment for thiamine deficiency. However, is that all they need? Let's think about this. For someone with thiamine deficiency, for example, someone with Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome, they're going to have very little ATP levels in their body because their metabolism is inhibited. If you were to give them just thiamine, sure, that's going to turn on those four enzymes that were initially shut down. But what does that do to their energy levels? Nothing. Just because these enzymes are not turned on, it doesn't mean that they can turn glucose into ATP if they don't have any glucose. So not only do you have to give them thiamine, you have to give them glucose as well. Then the question comes, which one do you give first? If you were to give them glucose first, all that glucose you give them will get funneled down into the glycolysis, and by the time it reaches the pyruvate, it's got a choice. Does it go down to acetyl-CoA, or do you take the anaerobic route and become lactic acid? Well, if you haven't given them thiamine yet, their PDH is still shut down. That means all that glucose you're giving them will get funneled into becoming lactic acid, so you might actually cause lactic acidosis in that patient, which is not good. So remember, when you're treating thiamine deficiency, always give thiamine first and then give glucose. Alright, and we're done. Hopefully the video was helpful. If you liked the video, give the video a like. And if you really liked the video, I would greatly appreciate it if you subscribe to the channel. That way it will help the channel grow. If you have any questions, comments, or topic requests, remember to put it down in the comment section down below.